Hey, it's Professor Dave. Let's talk about carbohydrates.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
We've all heard of carbohydrates and sugars, especially if we are loading up with energy for the big game, or if we're on a diet. But many people don't know that these words refer to the same class of molecules. Carbohydrates got their name because they are literally hydrates of carbon, molecules with several carbon atoms that each bear a hydrogen and a hydroxyl group. When they are small, they are also known as sugars, and their names end in -os, like glucose or sucrose, which is the sugar that we commonly refer to as simply sugar. Let's learn about monosaccharides first. These are the monomeric units that polymerize to form polysaccharides. We can name these according to the number of carbon atoms they have, which will be between 3 and 6. So a 3-carbon monosaccharide would be a triose. If it has 4 carbon atoms, it's a tetrose. 5 carbons would be a pentose, and 6 would be a hexose. In addition, all carbohydrates will have either an aldehyde or a ketone functional group in the molecule, so we would refer to those as an aldose or a ketose, respectively. Combining these conventions, we could refer to this monosaccharide as an aldohexose, and this one as a ketopentose. Each of these carbons, the ones that bear both a hydrogen and a hydroxyl, will be a chiral center, and the convention for drawing linear monosaccharides is to use Fischer projections. When we look at these, it is important to understand that each vertex is a stereogenic carbon, and we show the hydrogens and hydroxyls on either side. With Fischer projections, horizontal lines are implied to be wedge bonds, and the vertical lines are implied to be dash bonds. To remember this, just imagine a bow tie on each carbon, like it's going to the chemistry prom. Fischer projections are just a different way of visualizing a molecule, which we can see if we draw this molecule in line notation and view it from the side. The Fischer projection is what we would see if we were in the plane of the screen looking directly at the chiral center. However we choose to view it, it's important to realize that Fischer projections do not imply a flat molecule with 90-degree bond angles. These carbons are still tetrahedral. We just save time by drawing sugars this way. When we draw linear monosaccharides, we always put the aldehyde or ketone at the top and draw the rest of the molecule downwards, and we report the stereochemistry of the molecule by looking at the chiral center at the bottom, furthest away from the carbonyl. If on this carbon, the hydroxyl points right, it's a D sugar. If it points left, it's an L sugar. So we would call this D glucose, and this would be L glucose. This terminology is a bit more outdated than the R and S we use to assign absolute configuration, but the convention has stuck around, and it remains the way that we differentiate between enantiomers of sugar molecules. We got this from glyceraldehyde, the simplest sugar, and an aldotriose. This has only 1 chiral center, and we developed D and L terminology according to the 2 enantiomers of this molecule. For some reason, nature has selected to work with D sugars, so unless otherwise stated, we can assume that we are talking about D sugars. Let's also note that since a molecule with N chiral centers has 2 to the N stereoisomers, there are 2 aldotrioses, the 2 glyceraldehydes, since there is only 1 chiral center on the molecule. There are 4 aldotetroses, these 2 and their L enantiomers. There are 8 aldopentoses, these 4 and their L enantiomers, because of the 3 stereocenters, and a total of 16 aldohexoses, these 8 and their L enantiomers. These differ only in the stereochemistry of these chiral centers. Lastly, with Fischer projections, let's be sure to understand that swapping the position of 2 groups on a chiral center results in the inversion of that stereocenter and a totally different molecule. And while 90-degree rotations are forbidden because they invert stereochemistry, 180-degree rotations are allowed. Monosaccharides exist in an equilibrium between a linear and a cyclic form, with the cyclic form being highly preferred. They cyclize by an intramolecular hemiacetal formation, a mechanism we learned in organic chemistry. We know that when hemiacetals form, it's because an alcohol attacks an aldehyde, or ketone. In this case, it's an intramolecular cyclization, because the hydroxyl group and the carbonyl are on the same compound. Now, let's orient this linear molecule in a way that we can see the cyclization take place. We know that carbonyl carbons are sp2 hybridized and therefore exhibit planar geometry. So when the hydroxyl attacks the carbonyl, it can do so from either side, thus generating two different stereoisomers, which are called anomers. It can either attack from this side, pushing the new hydroxyl down, resulting in the alpha anomer, or it can attack from this side, pushing the new hydroxyl up, resulting in the beta anomer. That makes the resulting hemiacetal carbon the anomeric carbon, because we can either get the alpha anomer or the beta anomer, depending on which side the hydroxyl attacks from. When we draw cyclic monosaccharides, we sometimes use Haworth projections. With these, we look at the ring from the edge, meaning this part of the ring is closer to us, and this part is further away from us. And we show the functional groups projecting straight up and straight down. This does not accurately display the true geometry of the molecule, because we know six-membered rings, like these, prefer to be in a chair conformation. But Haworth projections have other practical uses. When we draw these, the convention is to place the anomeric carbon on the right, and the CH2OH on the other side of the ring, pointing up. If the new hydroxyl group that was generated during hemiacetal formation points down and is trans to this group, we have the alpha anomer. And if it is pointing up, cis to this group, we have the beta anomer. If a cyclic monosaccharide has a six-membered ring, we will call it a pyranose. But sometimes the hydroxyl on carbon 4 can do the attacking, resulting in a five-membered ring, which we will call a furanose. Rings smaller than this are unlikely to form due to ring strain. We should also note that monosaccharides don't always remain in the alpha or beta form. We can have an equilibrium between them, since the hemiacetal formation is completely reversible. This alpha glucose might go back to the linear form and then cyclize again to form the beta anomer. In fact, for glucose, the beta anomer is preferred because the hydroxyl on the anomeric carbon will be in the equatorial position versus axial in the alpha anomer. For this reason, a sample of glucose that has more of the alpha form than the beta will undergo mutarotation, which is a shift towards equilibrium values for the two anomers, which in the case of glucose is about 2-to-1 in favor of the beta anomer. A sugar will not always prefer the beta anomer. In some sugars, like mannose, the alpha anomer is preferred due to reasons of hyperconjugation that we call the anomeric effect. So we now know a bit about monosaccharides, their linear form, and the way they cyclize, and it is the cyclic form that is able to polymerize to form long polysaccharide chains. Let's learn about those next. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials, and as always, feel free to email me, professordaveexplains@gmail.com.